The first question I get asked as a magician is usually, how did you do that trick? Because of course, people are curious. When you perform, everyone wants to know the mechanics behind the trick. And most magicians answer it the same way. They either say quiet or they say it's the magician's code. And then the second and third questions are usually jokes like, hey, can you make my friend or wife disappear? Or can you create money out of thin air? So for the second one, we usually make up some clever reply. And for the third one, we say, if I could make money appear out of thin air, would I be performing at your wedding or at your private party? Usually, the fourth question is what confounds me the most, which is, how did you learn magic? Or how did you become a magician? Because it's not a very simple question to answer. I learned my first magic trick when I was 9, but does that count as me becoming a magician then? So, my family and I used to live at Fremont. In Fremont, this area in California, which was about a 7-hour drive from Vegas, which was at the border of California and Nevada. And my parents would go and have a quick monthly vacation once every 3 to 4 weeks. And all the casinos there, including, of course, Circus, had specific kid areas where you could leave your kids behind. They'd have their own shows going on. Clowns, of course, magicians, and all kinds of entertainers. And whenever I used to go there, I used to have at least, 6-8 hours for 2-3 days straight, getting a chance to interact with other performers there, other kids. But my main focus used to always be the magic shows. So whenever there used to be a magic show going on, I would just get up, run there, sit down, and probably watch the same show again and again and again. Honestly, my hope was if I watch this guy perform the same trick 5 nights in a row, or, 3 times in a month, then I'll at least be able to pick up one of his tricks. But of course, he's a professional magician, so I was never able to learn how he did it. And I was also 9. But a lot of these guys saw my determination and they gave me this small book of very basic card tricks. Those tricks, like 21 cards, the 11th positions, a very basic trick. But I at the age of 9, I was always enthralled by magic. So when I got that book, I started eating up all the tricks, and I learned the entire book's routines in probably a few days. I had them memorized. And, I could perform them in quite a simple manner. But does being able to do 1, 2, 3, or even 10 tricks make me a magician? I don't think so. The same way me being able to sing 10 songs or tell 10 jokes wouldn't make me a singer or a comedian. There are a lot more elements when it comes to being a proper performer than just being able to do the art on a very minimalistic level. And I genuinely believe that performance is one of the most important factors around magic, not just the tricks themselves. So let me give you a quick example of that. All right. If one of you could just unmute your mics right now and say hi to me. Anyone.
Hello, sir.
Hello, sir.
Okay, I'll use both of you. You can both stay unmuted. I'll use both of you. Okay. What are your names?
Dishan.
Okay. Chandra.
So, I'm going to show you one trick in two different variations, just to emphasize how important being able to perform properly is. So, let's start very simply, all right? I'm going to just quickly close my eyes and I'm going to deal cards down. So, whenever you're happy, you can just say stop.
Stop.
Okay. Can you look at this card? Don't tell me what it is, but you can see it, right?
Sure. Yes, sir.
Okay. So I'm going to slide it in quickly here and give the deck a quick shuffle. All right. Add this on top here and just give them a quick shuffle. If you can do me a favor and just name a number between 1 and 10.
7.
7. Both of you said 7. You want to change your minds or are you happy with 7?
No, sir. 7 is my lucky number.
7. Okay. So I'm going to just count down 7 cards. All right. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. What was your card?
Flower of 8.
Yes, that was the card.
And this is a decent trick, right? It's quite good. And this is one of the first tricks I learned. You make someone pick a card and you put it at whatever number they select. And it seems like a free choice. So it's great. Now, let me show you an updated version of this trick. And this was, by the way, probably the first or second trick I've learned. Now, even if you don't play cards, you should know what the suits are called. So, this is hearts, spades, clubs, correct?
Yes.
You have a diamonds here. So what I'm going to ask you to do right now is just name any playing card now. Just name out one card right now.
Nine of diamonds.
Nine of diamonds. Okay. Do you want to change your mind or are you happy with the nine of diamonds?
I'm happy with it.
Perfect. So I'm going to just go through the cards like this so we can both see them. Okay? And as I scroll through now, I think you'll notice that they're all different. They're not all the same card.
Yes.
Is that fair to say? Perfect. Okay. I'm going to just give them a quick shuffle. And whenever you're happy, just say stop.
Stop.
Okay. Perfect. I'm going to keep the cards down here. I want you to imagine a friend. Someone who's not on this call, but a friend that you've known for a while. All right. And of course, like we don't have a common friend circle. So I would have no idea who you're thinking of. What's the name you're thinking of?
Josh.
Josh. And is Josh on call right now?
No, he's not.
Not at all, right? So what I'm going to do right now, I'm going to J-O-S-H and your card was the nine of diamonds.
Oh, yes.
And they're not all nine of diamonds because like I said earlier, that would be quite a horrible trick.
Wow.
So I think most of us will agree when I say that the tricks were fairly similar, but the second one was a lot better. It was a lot more fun to watch. And that was for two reasons. One was that it had a more personal connection to it, which was rather than just a random number, I'm asking you a person's name, right? And if you really think about it, most names outside of a few Russian names and some other names here and there are less than 10 letters. So essentially what I'm asking you is for a number between 1 and 10, but just not as a number. I'm asking it to you as a name. So that gives it a more personal connection. But if you look at it fundamentally, that's the same thing there. The second thing is the fact that rather than taking out a card while dealing down, I asked you to think of one in the deck. But it doesn't change the fact that you still had to pick a card, right? So if you look at it from that perspective, both the tricks were essentially the same. But by adding a layer of performance to the time I performed it the second time, it became a lot more personal and a lot more polished. Even though the fundamental of both tricks is 99% the same. So I think this kind of helps us understand how important performance is in the art as a whole, rather than just being able to perform the trick. That's about, I'd say 30% of the fun is the trick and 70% is the performance and the jazz around it and audience interaction and being able to properly interact with each person and make it a personal experience for them. So when I started performing and I was around 9, right? So I learned it from a book. I didn't know exactly how I should go about interacting with others. So I would do tricks. I would perform thoda here, a little there. And now that I look back at it, I don't consider myself a magician then. Probably between the ages of 9 and 15 was the period when I practiced the most. Even now, I do practice a bit, but those were my formative years. And I would practice in front of mirrors, but nothing gave me the same feedback as when performing for friends or family. Feedback and input you get from an audience will always help you refine the art as opposed to just performing in front of a mirror because you have no feedback there. So I kept on performing for those 5-6 years in front of as many people as I could get. And I think that is what helped me define my personality as well as the way I interact with others when I'm performing. So was I a magician then? But was I a magician because I learned how to perform and I could do some tricks? Or was there still something missing? I think a big factor in this is focus and the ability to hone your mind and believe in what you're doing. Everyone's heard this line, right? If you believe it can happen, or if you believe you can do it. And while I feel that that line is somewhat of an exaggeration, there is definite truth to it. I don't know if there's a 100% chance of you believing in something and it happening, but I can definitely tell you that if you don't believe in something, it almost ensures failure. Any performing art, comedy, music, magic, an audience who sees a performer who doesn't have confidence and belief in themselves will always be able to tell this guy is not a professional. You have to give the audience a lot more credit in that. And the first thing you notice when someone walks on stage is the confidence of the person. So if you don't believe in what you are doing, then the audience is never going to believe in what you're doing either. And I think that plays a lot of very big role in what magicians do, and also I think comics and musicians and any other performing art on stage is the power of your mind. I'll give you an example of this. All right, when I used to perform initially, some of the moves I used to do was so outrageous. One of the moves I actually pulled off right now in the previous tricks was so outrageous that I used to think there's no way they won't figure this out. And then I realized that if I'm talking into the camera or into the person when I'm performing it, and I act as if nothing has happened, and they don't even know what the trick is, then why would they think that there's something fishy going on there? And I realized that if I believe that I'm doing something completely normal, and that there's no trickery going around, the audience will have no reason to suspect me either. The second you stop having any sort of confidence in your art, now, and especially in magic, when you need to be able to, I wouldn't say fool, but divert attention from the audience. If you don't focus properly and you don't have that inner confidence, which just comes from belief, you will always trip up one or the other time. Which is not to say that this is an overnight process. It's not like, yesterday I had doubts about my tricks and about how I would interact with an audience, and today in the morning I meditated for 2 hours and suddenly I can do everything. It's not an overnight process. It takes years. But the more you perform and the more you gain confidence in yourself, the more your tricks will become better and the greater your overall rapport as an artist will be with the audience. Or even if you're performing alone in front of a camera, just that fluidity of your hands rather than having doubt and dropping the cards. I think it's very important to have proper belief and focus. And with that comes a very important fundamental of magic, which is misdirection. Misdirection is, like I told you, I think 30% is the tricks. Maybe I would say 60% is performance. But the remaining 10% is so important, and that's misdirection. Misdirection can only come once you yourself have confidence in yourself as an artist. So I'll give you an example of misdirection right now. Can someone unmute their mic?
Yes, sir.
Okay. What's your name?
Yeah. Aman.
Aman. Aman, I'm going to again just show you all the cards are different. And I don't want to exactly explain how the trick is done. So all I'm going to do now is deal the cards down one by one. And whenever you're happy now, just say stop.
Stop. Yeah?
Perfect. Okay, yeah. So this is the card you have stopped at, Ten of Hearts. All right?
Okay, yeah.
Now,
yeah.
I will tell you where the misdirection comes here. I actually did something where I already showed you the card you were going to stop at about, I would say 2 minutes ago or about 50 seconds ago. But because I was moving around a lot and I just deliberately shifted my angle and motion, you weren't able to notice something, which is that this box has one card printed behind it, and that is the Ten of Hearts. If you look over here.
Yeah.
And honestly, misdirecting people with such a small frame is very difficult because I can't move the cards out. The second I move the cards out here, that's the second the trick completely falls apart because no one's going to have any trust in what I'm doing behind the stage. Even if I'm performing on stage, I can't go off the stage and come back on. At least if you're performing live, you can kind of move around here and there. And there are angles with which you can hide from an audience. That helps with misdirection. But it becomes much more difficult when you're performing virtually because everything has to be done in one frame. So in that case, the only misdirection available to me is talking and moving myself here and there while the objects of the misdirection stay in frame. And that's, like I said, where the confidence comes in. Once I had these two things down, I realized that I can start targeting much more harder tricks. Something that requires a lot more skill. The reason for that being, if you fail a trick that I'm performing, and either you mess up in some way that I hadn't anticipated, or I drop the cards, a beginning magician would panic and completely change to the next trick. But someone who's experienced, someone who has learned performance, someone who has a focused mind, someone who has belief in themselves, that they can make the audience think that this wasn't a mess up. This was actually a part of the trick. Then you get the bandwidth to start messing up a little bit more and taking risks with your performance. So let me show you one trick which I learned recently. And I would say is a very technically difficult trick, which has very little misdirection in it. But because I can perform properly and I can make the right decisions before the trick even starts, it becomes quite successful. I'll give you an example of this. If someone can unmute very quickly.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so I'm going to close my eyes, and for the most of this trick, I'm going to keep my eyes closed. Okay? I'm going to deal cards down now. Whenever you're happy, just say stop.
Stop.
Okay, can you see this card? Take a look at it.
Yeah.
Okay, I'm going to put it in the middle. Give it a quick shuffle like this. All right. And give it a shuffle here as well. Now, most people think that I kind of control the cards in some way. So, this is not your card, right? It's not on top.
No.
Okay. So, I'm going to give it a few more shuffles. Also, there's nothing in my sleeves. I just kind of roll them back because that's another doubt people have. I'm going to give it a quick shuffle like this. And here's where the skill level comes in. What I'm about to do right now is something I would have never attempted maybe even 4 or 5 years before. But because I have confidence and I know that even if this kind of messes up now, I won't tell you if I messed up or not until after the trick is done. But even if this kind of messes up now, I can probably pick myself up and misdirect everyone into thinking it was a part of the trick. So let me just try and find your card, all right? Was it this?
Yeah.
So, that's basically what I think it comes down to. The more you do as an artist, the more you do as an artist, the more it helps you learn and the more it helps you kind of bring other parts of your personality and art into fruition. I'll give you an example. If I didn't have my skills as a performer, I would not be able to pull this move off. If I didn't have my skills as an artist and in technique as a magician, I wouldn't be able to learn enough to even get to this point. And if I wasn't a good performer, then you wouldn't be interested in any of my tricks anyways. So each part is individually necessary. Misdirection feeds into the performance aspect. The performance aspect feeds into the actual technique because I know that even if I mess up, I can still try difficult things. And of course, the technique is what makes the whole trick work. So you realize why it's difficult for me to answer, how did you become a magician? The truth is, I don't know if I'm still a professional magician. Yes, I perform shows and I get paid. I perform for brands and celebrities all around the country. But the second I start thinking that I've become what I wanted to, is the second I start going down and declining as an artist. Every trick I learned and every trick I performed from the first trick has molded me into something better. And I'm a very different artist now than I was even 15 minutes ago because I've learned new things. I've learned maybe what an angle would be better for what trick. What kind of performance would be better for what kind of audience? Every performance, every trick, even experiences which have nothing to do with magic will help you shape your future and your overall portfolio as an artist. So when someone asks me, how did you learn magic? I don't tell them it was from a book at the age of 9. I don't tell them it was when I started performing. I don't tell them it was when I learned misdirection. When someone asks me that question, all I ask them is, do you have time for a 15 to 20 minute TED talk?